Revolution Radio proudly presents, live from the heart of the Blue Ridge, Roanoke, Virginia, it's the Just Bernard Show with host Bernard Alvarez. Join Bernard as he shares topics that reveal the real matrix and empower your human experience, including world liberty, the esoteric, suppressed technologies, spiritual ascension, and human consciousness. Humanity has awakened, and our time has come to realize our full potential. And now, live from the Star City, your host, Bernard Alvarez.
And hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of the Just Bernard Show here on Revolution Radio. I am your host, Bernard Alvarez, and we're going to be having a wonderful discussion today with our friend from across the pond, Gary Evans. We're going to be discussing ancient sites of England, as well as a lot of the work that Gary's been doing. But we're going to have Gary come on in just a moment. First of all, I'd like to, of course, welcome to all new listeners that are listening to us for the first time. Our show's been around for quite a while now, and we are very happy to be here on Revolution Radio. With me live on the chat, taking your questions for myself and Gary, is our assistant director, Trevor Knott, and he's joining us from Winnipeg, Manitoba, up in the Great White North. Hello, Trevor. How are you today?
Hello. Hello. I'm doing great. How about you?
I'm doing very well. I'm still cold. I think you guys are sending us your cold Arctic blast. Actually, I see it on the radar, so I'm going to blame Canada like South Park does. But oh, my gosh. We had a snowfall a couple days ago that just was out of this world. I cannot believe it's springtime here in Roanoke, but hopefully things are thawing down. I take it you guys are still a bit chilly up there too, huh?
We've warmed up a lot.
Oh, good. And for Canada, that's what, like five above? Or no, I'm kidding. And I guess the snow's still on the ground as well.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well, yep. Very good. Well, as I said, please, everybody, Trevor is on the chat waiting for your questions once we start our discussion with Gary. Today, we did have Maria Wheatley scheduled for today's show, discussing, of course, the ancient megalithic temples of England. Sadly, Maria has come down with a bit of a cold or a flu or something. And, of course, I'm going to do what everybody's doing and blame this late winter for that. But Maria will be rescheduling with us, and we hope she feels better very, very soon. Next week, we have a very special guest joining us, one of our contemporaries, for lack of a better term. Sonia from the Truther Girls will be joining us. And we're going to be discussing a lot of stuff that's going on YouTube. I don't know if you've been hearing about this, where we're getting a lot of us that are popular on YouTube are getting our accounts hacked. We're not sure if they're being done by shills or whatnot. But if you follow Sonia and the Truther Girls, she always has a lot of very interesting topics. And she's a good friend of ours, and she'll be joining us next week for a very, I'm sure, spirited discussion about what's happening in the world of the truth movement and other topics as well. So we look forward to having her. Without further ado, let me, first of all, I want to thank Gary for filling in for Maria. Gary Evans was recently on one of our programs on the GIC.org. Gary's been studying ancient cultures and earth mysteries for 20 years. And from his studies of ancient cultures around the world, he's realized how deeply our ancestors appreciated nature, something many of us have become disconnected from in this modern age. His keen interest in an unfamiliar chapter of prehistory before Sumeria has led to the website AtlantisEvidence.com and various lectures around the UK, US, and Egypt. And Gary is a regular contributor to international radio shows. He does wonderful tours to these great ancient sites where you get to, like, participate and feel the energy. So without further ado, let me welcome Gary Evans to the Just Bernard Show here on Revolution Radio. Good evening to you, sir. How are you?
It's good to be here. Yeah, thanks for having me on.
Well, we're great. We're very grateful that you were able to join us today, Gary. So thank you very much for filling in and being able to share the information that you're going to be sharing with us in just moments. How are you today?
I'm good, and I will do my best to fit in for Maria. She does have, we have a lot of common ground, which is why we're working together. I share my insights from traveling around the world, and she takes me to a lot of amazing locations in the Stonehenge landscape and the surrounding area. Because, most people have heard of Stonehenge, but what you don't realise is that there's, hundreds of sites in the surrounding area, and many of them are incredible. And Stonehenge is normally a lot of people there, so it's hard to have a bit of time to yourself.
Yeah.
So some of these outlying sites, you can just be and gain insights, and they're always in amazing places in the landscape as well. So she's definitely opened my eyes up in that kind of direction. So it's been good.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. And we're going to talk more about that in just a few moments. But for our listeners that might be new to you and your work, especially here on Revolution Radio, why don't you tell us a little bit about where you came from and how you ended up falling in love with this work that you're doing?
Well, in my late teens, there was a series of interesting events that made me kind of question this normal, boring reality that I was led to believe while I was at school. And I started doing a lot of research and occasionally visiting Stonehenge and places like that just in England. And like many people, kind of got absorbed into the system, working in an office. But I never really fitted into that dynamic as hard as I tried. So I'd kind of have these periods of working in an office and then leaving the job for a variety of reasons. Quite often the company's closed or something. And then I'd have these periods of studying earth mysteries and ancient cultures. Because the more I looked into it, it just seemed that our picture of what happened in the past was very cloudy. And a lot of it is just theories. The sort of generally accepted version of history is more often than not somebody's theory of what happened. I mean, it's not often fact. They can't prove it 100%. So it's all very ambiguous. And that's certainly true the further and further you go back. So I kind of had a growing interest. And then I started to go to yoga, which I would certainly attribute with turning my life around. Made me much more self-aware and the sort of growing level of empathy towards animals and other people. And so I'm quite into sort of philosophy, why people are the way they are, why they react to situations, what we can do about it, because we're quite often led to believe it's a result of our genetics or DNA and we're kind of powerless. Well, that's not what I've come to see and feel myself, because I've definitely changed as a result of, you could say, self-development or spiritual practices. So I'm very much into empowering people and hopefully sharing a few things that can help them along their path in life. Interested in people finding a way that they can pay the bills but do what they love. And the more of us that can sort of inspire each other and just inspire those around us. It doesn't need to be anything particularly grandiose, but we do need people like yourself with radio shows like this, getting on people that are kind of finding their way and all sharing really to move it forward. So that's kind of how I came into a PR role. So more often than not, I'm working with authors, helping to run conferences predominantly in the UK and US, and tours to Egypt, Peru, England and Ireland we've got coming up in the summer. Anywhere my kind of heart feels pulled towards, places I've visited that I feel help me. And I'm a firm believer in the kind of kindred spirits coming together mm-hmm. as well, which is why conferences and tours are good, because I felt for a very long time isolated, you could say, with looking into the mysteries and sort of questions I had about life. And then when I suddenly had a circle of similar-minded friends spending time with people researching these subjects and exchanging ideas, it was a huge empowering experience. And that is something I'm now actively trying to do, to spread the word on the people who I believe in, who inspire me, and then pulling us together in certain places to share ideas and hopefully make the world a better place in some small way.
Absolutely. And, you know, I can relate 100% to what you're saying as far as the motivation to bring people together. One of our intention when we created the GIC was to create a spot on the web for people to find each other. And you've done a wonderful job of not only doing it on the internet, but doing it on the ground by creating these wonderful conferences. So I thank you for being a part of, you know, part of the story of bringing humanity together. I think that's just wonderful.
Thank you.
Now, Gary, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say thank you and ditto. Yeah, we were many of us, yeah, working towards the same goal. And I do feel fortunate that my job allows me to see the kind of bigger picture around the world, because sometimes there might be this kind of picture when you look at the mainstream bad news, as it normally is, with the occasional sort of positive story that sneaks through the net. But yeah, there's a lot of us working towards the same goal, so that I feel a lot of encouragement knowing that.
Absolutely, and I think it's again, it's all a part of the. I'd like to think it's the cosmic puzzle coming together, you know, just bringing us one step closer to a united world, a united consciousness, if that's the word that is appropriate. But speaking of the tour, I'm very interested in hearing a little bit about this tour that you're going to be doing with Maria and the ancient sites of the UK. Now, it's funny that maybe about a month ago, and I think we had been out of touch for about a month or two because you've been busy touring yourself, and we got back in touch on email. And I was motivated to watch a documentary on the ancient castles of the UK. And they were talking about the difference between the wood castles and the stone castles. I mean, this has really nothing to do with the, or maybe it does, as the spiritual sites. But it did really pique my interest in how, not only how ancient some of these sites are, and, you know, as Maria says, they're probably older than we feel or think that they are. But it just, I don't feel that, especially here in the States, that people realize how amazing some of these structures are. And I'm taking it that you're going to be touring some of these sites.
Yes. Well, what we tried to do, because I deal with a lot of international guests on my other tours, I thought, well, we've got all these amazing places that we know in the southwest of England, Glastonbury, Stonehenge, Bath, and there's sites all in between them that Maria and I visit in our spare time, and we just love them all. So how about we combine that with a tour of Ireland and all the magical sites over there, and then it's really will give anyone that's had a sort of desire to visit England and Ireland a really great overview of both, because there is a kind of, you could say, sacred responsibility when you're organising tours. It is a passion of mine, and I really do care about people. And at the end of the day, we are dealing with people's dream trips. More often than not, their once-in-a-lifetime trip to Egypt or Peru, perhaps UK and Ireland, if people choose to join us. And I take that very seriously. The fact that we can visit these places, look after people, grow, and perhaps get a little bit of monetary return is, I mean, I can't imagine anything more amazing. There isn't anything I'd rather be doing. I'm quite happy with how my path's unfolded, and I've had some amazing feedback from guests that they do feel that they've been touched and and their kind of perspective on life has changed. Because we're quite often at these amazing locations and discussing the state of the world and the kind of how different it could be if you got a group of us together that really do care about these issues that you regularly cover on your show. If we were pulling the strings, or we made the, perhaps I'd be interested to make the Dalai Lama the president of the world just for a little while and see how that went.
I agree.
Could be an interesting experiment. So, we're really looking forward to it. It's going to be July the 15th to 28th, so it's 14 days. We spend sort of 5 to 6 in the UK, fly over to Dublin, and one exciting development that's occurred is I've connected with this Irish author and tour guide, James Swagger, who's kind of burst onto the scene recently. He's got his own radio show and things, and he's going to be able to get us into a few places that are quite hard to get into, that most tourists wouldn't know about. And he's also got an interest in the acoustics of these sites, which is one of my personal areas of research.
Mm-hmm.
Sound, the effect of sound on our consciousness or awareness, how we feel at these places. And there is definitely more and more coming out about the effects of frequency on consciousness. So I'm heavily looking into that. I've spent a lot of time in Egypt, and many of the sites there do point in that direction. And we've had some incredible experiences as group experiences, because I do like shared experience, because it's if you're just kind of going on your own feelings, sometimes I think you can get a bit carried away in the moment. But if you've got a group experience, then you're able to kind of share the impressions and the feelings. And if you're all experiencing something very similar, then perhaps there's something tangible at the sites that we visit that's sort of allowing these experiences to unfold. And that's what I'm really interested in. Where can we go that helps our path unfold, that gives us these sort of intuitions, gives us greater clarity? I'm not just looking at taking people on a kind of generic tour,
right,
to have take a few photos and then back on board the bus.
There's
thousands of people probably doing that already. I'm focused on always on what's the next step. We've got to this point in time through these kind of areas of research. So where does it go now? What's relevant to each person? It's moving the boundaries forwards. And there's a group of people focused on the same things. I know you've had Brian Forster on the show, because I do quite a lot with him, and he's fantastic. And the people I work with in Egypt, Patricia and Yusuf Awam, spend a lot of time with them. They live just near the base of the Sphinx. And Yusuf's father was Hakim, who was very well respected across the world. I think he used to sort of guide American members of Congress and things around when they went over to Egypt. So he built this amazing reputation, and Yusuf and Patricia are carrying on his legacy, because he sadly passed over a few years ago. So I kind of have these people in key places, and we go to these locations that are not always perhaps accessible to members of the public. And I'm a kind of a firm believer in getting an overview across the world, because it seems like we've lost so much in a lot of the locations, but little clues at these sites are left. So, there is certainly a line between them that seems to convey a general understanding, and we could probably go into that later. And that may extend to some kind of crystal technology, which is something I do discuss in my lectures. There's certainly some strange anomalies. I've seen these on location. And, there's some big questions that need to be answered still.
Absolutely. And speaking of questions that need to be answered, are you and Maria, I don't want to say addressing, but going into some of these sites that maybe you haven't seen yet, is there anything specific that you're looking for when you go to these sites here in Ireland or in the UK for this particular tour?
Yeah, well, my side of it is, you could say, the ambiance of the site, which ones haven't been too interfered with, because a lot of them have been rebuilt or reconstructed, so we want to visit ones that are as intact as possible, and that is something that we've accomplished. We're going to go and visit almost a fully intact stone circle in Ireland, which has a completely different feel to a site that's been reconstructed, I'm sure. And so the commonalities between Egypt and Peru with the acoustics, that's my kind of side of it. Maria's very much into the, you could say, archaeoastronomy, the energies of the site. She does work with Chinese geomancers. I mean, she has people visiting her from all over the world, people from Tibet. So she's kind of got the energy perspective, probably a kind of overview of how these sites are interacting with natural energies, that are subtle energies that are present in the earth. I think we just need to get a bit more sort of in-depth about things, because normally we get a generic explanation. All stone circles are ceremonial sites, but we're looking at them with different functions, perhaps enhancing the energies, and there's other features in these landscapes. And there's a kind of a pyramid type structure that's near the world's biggest stone circle, Avebury, which we'll be visiting. And that almost, we think, is acting as either a kind of a battery or a capacitor that sort of holds a charge. And then you're really looking at how water perhaps is generating a very subtle energy by filtering through the limestone or chalk at these sites, because there's a lot of similar features to Giza, where the Great Pyramid is, and the sort of Stonehenge landscape, and water, crystal sort of shafts, or something that allows energy to flow. There seems to be a lot of similar features like that in both landscapes. And again, you could say this similar for Peru.
With the underwater channels, is that what you mean?
Yes. Yeah, and how they're guiding water to the sites, or perhaps harnessing sort of underground aquifers. And you can measure a very subtle charge when water's filtering through this kind of limestone or chalk soil. Mm-hmm. So that's something we do know that is generated when water's filtering through. So if you could somehow harness that or channel it, I mean, we're not in the realms of science fiction here. I think we're not far away from understanding finer forces.
Yeah. Or what I like to call the subtle energies that we just need to really just pay attention to.
And that is something that when you're, you could say, on the spiritual path or making yourself more sensitive to these things, you do become more aware of them. And I've spent time with lots of people that can feel these forces when they're at the sites. So, I think we're just getting to the point of understanding a bit more about what our ancestors did know. Perhaps they didn't have quite the same understanding of it as we do now that we've worked all these things out using various scientific disciplines, but perhaps it just came more naturally to them, and they knew it was going to help them on some level.
Now, let me ask you, has there been evidence of, let's say, a common, site of Stonehenge, has there been evidence of water running underneath the hill there?
That, it is on the top of a hill, and there's a river not too far away.
Oh, okay.
So, with the British climate, it almost feels like it rains every two or three days across the year. So there you're going to have fairly consistent rainfall, unless it's a particularly dry year. So yes, I think you can safely say that there's going to be a subtle energy generated there fairly consistently.
Absolutely. And I find that, you know, when the channels make a connection, an X, for lack of a better term, a lot of times that creates energy points. And I know that you've worked with people that work with the ley lines as well. And I believe Maria does as well. And are you going to be doing any kind of research or how shall we say, presentations on that as well during the tour?
Yes, we certainly will be. Maria teaches, a variety of different things, and one of those is dowsing. And so she's taught me, and sometimes I help her passing that on when we're looking after groups. So she's got an amazing background in dowsing, including water divining, which she's done with great success in the past, and they've drilled wells where she's directed people to and found the water. So yes, she's very intuitive and gifted like that, and so it is nice to share the dowsing with people and for them to really be able to start to feel these energies. I think the dowsing rods for me, because I'm very sensitive anyway. Normally I can feel things with my body,
right?
But sometimes weather conditions, if it's very windy or rainy, don't help so much. So the dowsing rods kind of act as a further antenna, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And once I can kind of feel something with them, I've become more aware of it with just my body sometimes and my hands. So a lot of people like to see that, and you do get some interesting results. One of the places we go to, West Kennet Long Barrow, if you hold a dowsing rod just loosely in your hand, it'll spin round, say, clockwise, and then stop, and then it'll spin round anti-clockwise. And I think Maria normally calls that a kind of energy vortex. Mm. And that's in the central chamber in this long barrow, which normally is just explained as a kind of burial chamber. But perhaps before it was a burial chamber, it was somewhere they went and visited for other purposes, and then became a burial chamber later on. Or maybe it was always used for both.
Right.
We've just forgotten.
Unbelievable. And I just love, the fact that, you know, she does work with dowsing. So many people have really tried to push that art aside. And it's, I love how it seems to be making a resurgence. And it's becoming a little more mainstream, especially if you live in an agricultural community. And welcome back to the Just Bernard Show here on Revolution Radio. We are speaking with Gary Evans about lots of interesting sites around the world. And before we left for the break, we were speaking about the tour that he's going to be doing and heading with Maria Wheatley. Gary, when is the tour going to be?
It's July the 15th to the 28th.
Okay, great. And I'm assuming that's pretty good weather for you guys.
Well, we've hit in July. I was writing out a kind of weather report for the web page, and it says Great Britain has a variable climate. So that means I'm recommending that international guests bring summer clothing and wet weather gear.
Okay, that sounds about right, huh?
July, I mean, we can have very nice Julys. It can be in the 80s and 90s quite regularly. After last year, who knows? It was very wet.
Right.
But we should hopefully have at least a few nice days of sun, because it really does make things a lot more enjoyable.
And before we start talking about more in-depth topics, can you tell everybody what website they could go to get more information on the tour?
Yes, certainly. My website is infinite, as in infinity, infinite-connections.co.uk. I'm on Twitter, connections_PR. Facebook, I've got Infinite Connections group and pages. People are welcome to find me on there under Infinite Connections and Gary Evans. You're always happy to answer questions. Just generally trying to spread a bit of light onto a few of these mysteries and get people involved. I think that's the time we're at.
Yeah. Absolutely. And now speaking, let's move on to the a little bit more about mysteries. Is, you know, one of the things that we, I guess, for lack of a better term, the general public can't help but notice is a lot of similarities between sacred sites around the world, whether it be in Bali or Indonesia or Peru or Egypt or even the UK. We're seeing a lot of architectural similarities. And you can't help but wonder, was there a culture back then, a global culture? Was it before the Pangea, you know, giant plate, before we fell apart into separate continents? So I was wondering what has your studies and what are your hypotheses on the idea of so many similarities around the world?
Well, this is, one of the intriguing subjects I've spent a lot of time talking to people about. I made a website that called Atlantis Evidence, which listed the sort of top 10 anomalous features, sites, and artifacts that I'd found in my research. So if anyone was just starting to look into these subjects, I hope it will give them a little kickstart into various different areas, because there's a lot to research. And the kind of point I'm at is I'm confident that we're definitely missing a big piece of our history. The site that most people talk about these days to prove that point is Göbekli Tepe in Turkey, which they've dated to 10,000 BC, and it has these amazing stone columns that weigh somewhere between sort of 4 and even up to 20 tons. And that's a point in time where we're told we're just hunter and gatherers, and there's no kind of organized society. Well, this site in Turkey blows that theory completely out of the water. So what we do know now is that there was organization back at 10,000 BC. People, because once you're building, it's a massive site, 20 acres. So once you're at that level, you've got to have food production, obviously stonemasons, some way of transporting the stones from the quarry. So it shows quite a sophisticated organizational structure, far more advanced than our history books are still saying today. And there's probably more of these sites that are going to come to light. I mean, mm-hmm. We've got lots of things underneath the oceans and buried. I mean, there's plenty more under the sands in Egypt that I'm hoping will be revealed when we're at a place that we can respect what we find. Perhaps these things are kind of have been lost to us for a good reason. We're not civilized enough to handle things. So that's I'm encouraged. There's plenty more out there to find, and the way I would see it is some kind of, there's definitely a global connection. We always see the oceans as a barrier to our ancestors, but they're the kind of highways around the world. And it was only about 4 or 6 weeks ago where they found this kind of cache off the coast of, well, it was just on the coast of Egypt, and it was a sort of sophisticated evidence of seagoing travel. Had all the ropes and the different artifacts you'd need. And so it does seem to show that the ancient Egyptians were traveling around on the oceans to some degree or another. And they're credited with inventing the sail kind of around 3,500 or 3,000 BC. They've got these huge ships that they found outside the Great Pyramid in pits, which is a very strange anomaly. But these are massive boats there, and potentially ocean going. So I think there was a lot more contacts around the planet than we think. Be comfortable to say that.
Right, right. And, you know, my own as well, and I don't know if I'm just fantasizing or whatnot, but I feel that maybe there was either some type of, whether it be air travel or maybe some sort of telekinesis or some type of portal travel as well. We're looking at something. A good example would be like the pyramids in Mexico, and Egypt, and you can't help but wonder, there has to be some type of collective information that they both cultures must have used, and how do they get that information is what I'm playing with. And
yeah.
I can't help but wonder, if, were they advanced enough where they could do remote viewing, perhaps, something to that effect?
Well, I could offer a few ideas, because generally I try and stay away from kind of, you could say, wild speculation.
Right.
But one of the big pieces of the puzzle that I think is often overlooked is the spiritual dimension, or our consciousness in this whole puzzle. Because if we're just looking at it from a kind of logical mindset, a lot of these things don't make any sense. Why did they build this site? Why did they put all the energy into making the Great Pyramid? And more often than not, these things are kind of dismissed as either an artifact of some crazy pharaoh's ego, or just as a sort of ceremonial place. But I think there's a much deeper aspect that they were getting something out of these sites. There was a reason they put so much energy into making the Great Pyramid, because there's going to be a byproduct of that building. Ditto for the stone circles. And there are reports at some of these sites, you could say, of time slips. Maria could tell you a very good story about time slips reported by army. I think it was army officers near Stonehenge. And similar things have happened at Avebury. I've been to a place in Peru, the doorway of a Marumuru, which is often called a stargate. I was very keen to go down there because it sort of had this huge mystique, and I wanted to find out for myself whether I thought there was something sort of tangible there, or if it was just wild speculation to try and get people to listen to radio shows on the internet.
Right.
And that site definitely didn't disappoint me. It was incredibly powerful. And there are stories of people disappearing in front of that doorway. And I think it normally is connected with using sound in some way, from my research. And the Serapeum, which is a very mysterious site in Egypt, which I was in December, has these huge granite boxes, which weigh sort of between 80 and 100 tons. And the precision of the engineering is just amazing. So if we're going to look at, I think, by location, I don't know if they would necessarily bilocate the physical body. If you looked at it from a spiritual perspective, I mean, there's even stories that come out of India today about these kind of yogis and people like that that can be in two places at once. We still do have these kind of stories.
Mm-hmm.
So what they were capable of back in the day when some of these sites were functioning would probably surprise us, I think. I don't know if it was generally the majority of people, perhaps, as it is now, secrets are in the hands of just a few. Hopefully
right.
they're using it for the greater good of the many. And remote viewing and things, again, the Tibetan monks are kind of credited with that today. Is that something that many of our ancestors could do, shamans and things? There's often reports of the pharaohs kind of going out of body over to the other side to get information for the greater good of the population, to try and kind of guide the future of the civilization and things like that. So I think, yeah, we will get to the bottom of a few of these things, but we must remember, in my opinion, our inner sensitivity and spiritual path and opening up to these possibilities rather than just dismissing them out of hand without researching them. So we need to be more open-minded. We don't know everything, even though we'd like to think we do. The universe is a vast place, and our species has barely scratched the surface. We're just about getting off of our planet.
Oh, absolutely. You can say that again. And,
yeah.
You know, there are also many theories out there that, we were a very evolved race for a while before, you know, the cataclysm, whatever that is, but it seems to be a common theme in many cultures having some type of a cataclysm, what, 10, 20, 30,000 years ago, as well, even maybe an off-planetary influence giving information. For all we know, they could have been jumping around from continent to continent, sharing architectural plans, you know. Anything is possible, you know. I was going to say, that's the main thing that you're saying, is that we have to be open to the fact that anything is possible and to really allow ourselves to move into finding more information on it.
Yes. Yeah. And I think that's what the how modern science will help us move forward. There's certainly a place for it. My feeling is we've just gone too far in the direction, in the West particularly, too far removed from our route, because my greatest inner peace more often than not comes from spending time in nature, and I'm a big animal lover, and it really does help to center me to have those moments. And so it does worry me when we're completely removed from that kind of environment. I mean, I can't speak for everybody, but just to be out in these amazing places in our on our wonderful planet gives me a lot of pleasure. And I think it does for many of us, particularly once we're starting to explore these mysteries and things. There's a certain appreciation that comes from just being quiet and spending time with animals that sitting in front of a computer just doesn't give me.
Yeah, or watching it on a screen or something like that.
Mm-hmm. That inspires us to go out and spend time there. And I've certainly been working on a few techniques to try and get back to these things, because why is it relevant to the people listening today? How do these places tie into their life? That's the kind of questions I'm trying to work on. These are not just dead locations that are kind of irrelevant today. We can still learn a few lessons. And I think there were practices in the past we've thrown away that we should probably take a second look at.
Absolutely. And, you know, to talk a little bit more about, like, mainstream history or mainstream science, you can't help but wonder. A good example would be, let's say, the Museum of History in Egypt, where there are so many artifacts that no one has even seen or that they've put into the basement that is not available for public viewing. Mm-hmm. I've known, I forgot who it was that I spoke to that, maybe it was Brian, maybe it was, or someone along those lines, of how even the tour guides are told what to point out and what not to point out to the public. And I can't help but wonder if, you know, is the, you know, and again, not to sound too much like a conspiracy person, but is there something that they're trying to hide from us that they know, you know, as far as what they're telling the general public? So how much of it is already known that is not being shared with us, and how it is important for us to take it upon ourselves and alternative communities and alternative researchers to really try to get to the truth and the heart of the matter?
It does definitely happen from what I can see, and it happens in Egypt, happens in Peru, and it happens in England. Maria was kind of making some progress in the Stonehenge. They allowed her to put a kind of, you could say, a few alternative theories into a little pamphlet that just described some things about dowsing and things, and that was selling incredibly well. So they were kind of becoming a bit more open-minded. I'm not sure if that's still continuing or not. I think there's a variety of reasons, because it's very easy to go down the conspiracy route.
Yeah.
But I think there's a variety of reasons why these things are happening. There's a kind of a fear of the unknown. There is a general sense that the powers that be know everything, and they like to kind of, I think, maintain that picture, the various archaeological disciplines and Egyptologists and everything, that they've got all the answers, and so we should just listen to them. So quite often the anomalies will be discarded on that area. They do like to paint a picture when you're at the sites, I think the guides, so they do seem to avoid pointing out things that we would point out on our tours, and the reason that a lot of people go to these places, they're kind of intrigued by looking at these things on the internet. And the internet's not always right. It certainly does go quite crazy, I think, sometimes. That's one of the things I've learned by visiting these sites. And again, look, you need to look at it from a kind of holistic perspective. And I like to base things on at least, yeah, something tangible, and getting to the bottom of truth rather than deluding myself. Because a lot of these subjects are very nice to think about. I think we do enjoy thinking about some things that are quite wild sometimes. But we need to stay fairly grounded, I think, for our greatest good. But there's plenty of mysteries out there that are quite wild by normal standards, so I wouldn't be too disheartened. And the other thing that I... And, of course, there's kind of political reasons, some places religious reasons why things won't be mentioned if there's conflicts on those fronts. So, yeah, there's a variety of factors that if you go around just with one of these normal guides, you're going to get quite a bland picture, unfortunately, more often than not. Not to say that always happens. There's a few, I think, enlightened guides. If you're lucky, you might come across one.
Yeah, it's almost as if the established, well, I guess for lack of a better term, the established hierarchy has this generic picture that it wants to portray, and anything that doesn't go along to that is frowned upon, or it's ridiculed, or is just completely hidden and lied about.
Mm. Yeah, the ridicule is certainly one of their favorite weapons, and that's why you do have to be careful with a bit of speculation, because you might have a perfectly valid theory about one area, but they will attack you if you go off on a kind of tangent about something else. They just try and find a weakness that the mass consciousness or the most people will think, well, that doesn't make sense with my worldview. And then the really solid research is lost in the as a consequence.
Absolutely. Now, Brian Forrester, one of the last things he said on our show was he felt that it was the right of humanity to know the truth, and how it's so important for us to really put ourselves out on a limb to look and search for it, and to really, basically his final words were, humanity deserves to know the truth. And
wise words.
I can't help but wonder, you know, what did we not get to talk about? Because I'm sure he didn't cover everything. And I've got to say that, you know, that is very motivating. I think that's very motivating words, very wise words. And something that we really need to continue doing on shows like this, and with the work that you're doing, and everyone who's got, you know, their websites, alternative news websites and whatnot, because a lot of times I find that alternative sites or whatnot focus mostly on the political aspect of our lives, mm-hmm. and they forget that there are things like science and technology that are also being hidden and not being shared, archaeology or history. I mean, so much that we're forgetting about that is a part of our wholeness, of our whole humanity. And I love what you're doing, because I feel that for me, I've always been very interested in, where did we come from? How did this happen? You know, where did that come from? How did they do that? And we seem to, for me, I find I'm very empowered just by looking at a picture. I'm looking at your picture right now, standing in front of the Sphinx and the pyramids. And just looking at that picture, for me, elates me. It gives me a certain boost, you know, seeing those images. And I can't help but wonder how that works on the subconscious, everyone. And is it a part of our evolutionary process? You know, all of these sites, all of these symbols, all of these shapes, you know, the energy that's coming from them. And were they created to really help us evolve?
Well, there's a lot of points I could pick up on there. The first one would probably be, there's a little hotel that overlooks the Sphinx and the pyramids that I stay at before our tours start, and it is a captivating view. It's just like you never get tired of looking at it. Every time I go back, it's almost like it's the first time and I'm there again in this majestic place with so much history. And that's the feeling at a lot of these sites. I have to tear myself away from them every time. There's just something going on, and I can almost feel it on a sort of subconscious level that it makes me feel happy. I enjoy being there. There's a kind of sense of inner peace, all these kind of things. And the guests on our December tour in Egypt, it's hard to describe what it's like to be in Egypt. It's very different to being in a Western city. And there is definitely a powerful energy, for want of a better term. And a lot of the guests had trouble sleeping the first few nights they arrived in Egypt. It was just so powerful for them, they couldn't even get to sleep at night. So that's kind of a telling sign.
Mm-hmm.
And in terms of our collective history, because it really depends on what kind of perspective you're coming at these mysteries from. I think there's one kind of perspective where if you say the culture's older, the people that live in a country feel a little bit offended that perhaps it was somebody else and it wasn't their ancestors. So I think that we have to be mindful of that. But if you come up to a kind of greater perspective and you see how fractured we are as a species, and the astronauts normally say when you look at the planet as a whole, when you don't see these borders that we see on maps, there aren't any borders in nature, it's only man-made boulders. There's one species on this beautiful blue planet that just so divided. So we've got to somehow move past some of these historical divisions and come together. So I'm hoping that we can stop focusing on the tiny differences, because we share far more in common with each other than we have differences as a species. And then when you're kind of up at this greater perspective, we're talking about our collective history, our roots. And if we've forgotten where we've come from, I think most people that I've heard talking about it, it makes it harder to see where you're going. And so there is a responsibility, I think, on the people looking into these subjects to try and get to the bottom of it for everybody and clear some of these things up. And hopefully help us come together as a species and start looking after our beautiful world and the animals, because that's kind of my main.
Welcome back to the Just Bernard Show. We are having a very intriguing and, what can I say, amazing conversation with Gary Evans on many different topics based on many Earth mysteries. Before we went on the break, Gary was talking about a little bit about a part of our evolution, and I was hoping we could move the direction of the conversation a little bit toward that, Gary, in reference to some of the work that you have not only doing with yourself, but some of the experiences that you've been having on some of these sites, mm-hmm. in reference to what brings us to the next level, the next higher vibration of consciousness.
Yeah, it's probably one of my favorite subjects. Thank you for asking that.
Great.
Well, I've certainly shared some amazing experiences at some of these locations. My kind of approach is, you could say, a group consensus or working with others. The fact that I get to share these amazing locations with so many different people of like-minded nature is helping to give me a broader perspective on things. And I feel very blessed to be able to get that perspective, because it ties into my own research and allows me, I think, to share these sites in an even greater way with future guests, because that's kind of where my focus is on. Because moving from the kind of office work environment to the ancient sites is quite a big transition. And of course, a lot of people that want to visit these places go there to take photos and have them as memories. But you can explore them from a kind of internal perspective if you've been working on yourself and researching these subjects. There's a whole different world that you can explore, and that's where I really take a lot of heart from that. And I could describe one of my most meaningful experiences, which perhaps would be a good example
to everybody
listening. I think it sort of shows what the potential is for us, because visiting a lot of these sites, one thing that has happened on a number of occasions is that I feel like I've become more in touch with my soul or greater essence of myself, and I can't prove that. Can't prove that to a scientist, but I can't prove that I love somebody to a scientist very easily either. It's something that I felt and knew when it happened. And so one of our experiences was at Luxor Temple. There was a group of six of us, and it's an incredibly moving place, Luxor. The work of Schwaller de Lubitz, which John Anthony West quite often references, and he talked quite a lot about this heart-based emotional intelligence. And I think Schwaller spent about 20 years at Luxor. And based on my experiences there, I would say anybody that spent 20 years at Luxor and started to talk about this heart-based emotional intelligence is somebody that's worth listening to.
Right.
I think he probably gained quite a few very deep insights in that amount of time there, because it's touched me, I think, almost more than anywhere else that I visited in the sort of short few-hour visits that I've had. So I regularly try and fit in extra trips there on the tours and take a few guests with me. And the kind of culmination of one of our trips there was normally in a temple, you walk through the temple, and at some point towards the end, you're going to have an inner sanctum. Quite often it's called the Holy of Holies, but I don't necessarily think that's the best term for them. So inner sanctum, the kind of most powerful spot, the most revered spot, perhaps where the ancient rituals, as we would call them, took place. And so anytime you can get a sort of 20-minute or something meditation in somewhere like that, it's a huge blessing, because the tourism, as a lot of people may be aware, in Egypt has gone down since the revolution. But the positive side of that for guests visiting now is that these sites that are normally inundated with other tourists are quite often virtually empty. Occasionally we do get them to just our group. So from the guest's perspective joining us, it's a rare opportunity. And so we ended up in the inner sanctum. This was in 2011. And I felt like I'd learned a few toning techniques, like chanting with ohms and ahs, that kind of thing. And so you could say I was kind of leading our group. I prefer to think of it as a kind of a space holder type role. And it culminated in a group out-of-body experience, which was completely unexpected at the time. And from my perspective on it, we were using sound, and there was a group harmony between the six of us. And then I kind of felt this sharp pain in the top of my head. And it was almost like I could see this kind of white tunnel coming from the middle of my forehead, like I was looking through my head, and I could see this white tunnel extending up. And then the next kind of feeling was like I was sucked upwards, or my consciousness was, not physically. Mm-hmm. And then the kind of next thing that I was aware of was this just a huge unconditional feeling of love. There was a kind of awareness of myself, Gary, as the kind of consciousness, but also an awareness of being connected to everything. And it was almost like I could kind of see individuality, but the individuals were all like an ocean. So the best analogy is there was kind of a sea of consciousness, and I could make out individual drops in this sea, but it was a sort of flowing sea of awareness.
Right.
And so it was like way beyond any kind of physical awareness. And from all I can say is I would call that the source. At this point in time, I'm not aware of anything beyond that. And it was certainly just the feeling of love there, and the unconditional love was incredible. I think it was kind of the main thing that I was searching for, because after being there, this kind of itchy feeling where I seem to remember sort of more harmony than I normally see on this planet. There was certainly harmony there. The feeling of this unconditional love was just kind of overflowing. So that was me, you could say, I think, out of body.
Right.
And then I snapped back to kind of consciousness, conscious of my surroundings again. And so the first thing I did was open my eyes and kind of stretch my hand to see if it was still working, the body. So I was like stretching my hand, like, yeah, okay, it seems to be working again. And then I could feel this unconditional love kind of flowing in to the top of my head and down my spine. And so then I had I was conscious of the world, and I was conscious of this feeling that I'd been experiencing on the other side. So then it wasn't quite so sort of removed or subjective. So I still have a memory of this unconditional love flowing into me, probably one of the most moving or the most moving moments of my life.
Mm-hmm.
And then everybody that was with me, the other five people, seemed to kind of come around at the same time. Nobody was talking or anything when I snapped back. And when I looked around, I could see in their eyes that we'd all gone to somewhere that meant a huge amount to us. And I would like to think I'm the kind of person that can go out, have these experiences, and then share them, because that's, I think, part of my path to try and inspire others to follow their hearts and visit these places or inspire other people. So it's no good me having a kind of amazing experience and not describing it to others. But when you have an experience that's so personal as that, a lot of people obviously have difficulty conveying it.
Yeah.
And so at the time when I was asking the people with me what they experienced, it was beyond, I think it was beyond words. It took me a while to be able to sort of vocalize it in a way that I could explain to others. But eventually one of my friends that was there, she did write a paragraph to me about her experience, and it mirrored my own. She went to this place where she just felt this amazing unconditional love. And I did a talk at James Gilliland's ranch, the Ascetic Ranch, which is well worth a visit.
Yeah.
If you can get out in that direction. And when I compared my story, my friend's story of what she experienced, and James's near-death experience, you could basically be, it's the same, almost identical, what he went through. And he's got a lovely heart and really cares about others. So it's like if you go to this place and suddenly have a real sense of how we are all connected on one level. So I kind of look at it now as it's a conscious universe. We're fully integrated into that. And one of the challenges down here is remembering that fact. So anyone listening to this show today is already made the biggest step and started to look outside of the information that's just generally available.
And if I may jump in for a moment, because you're speaking about James Gilliland, he's going to be on Revolution Radio in a few hours with our good friend Roxy Lopez.
Aha!
So it's a kismet, total synchronicity.
He's a great guy. We have a lot of time for James, and the community at ESETI almost felt like going home. It was similar to our tours where you just have all these like-minded people, and he's really pulled some fantastic girls and guys to him. So
yeah,
if you can get out in his direction, and there's definitely something tangible in terms of in the sky.
Yeah.
the mothership didn't arrive. I was hoping it would because I have a few questions for them. But I did see some things in the sky through the night vision goggles and with my own eyes that I've never seen anywhere else.
Yeah.
And in terms of light sort of bending, it was all at quite high altitude. But yeah, strange and difficult to explain. So he's definitely got something there, and I think people would enjoy their time if you can get out there.
Absolutely. You know, and speaking of your experience, because I think we spoke about this before, and I had a very a parallel experience to what you had as far as feeling, having that out-of-body experience, connecting with the source, seeing the sea of consciousness. And I remember, for me, and I don't know if you had the same experience, whether it was, well, for lack of a better term, audio, but I had a voice saying, now you have to go back and show them how to come here, or go back and show them the way back, something to that effect, to put it into human terms, right. A little difficult. But it was like, okay, now this is what you have to do. And I'm wondering if you had a similar experience.
Well, that's interesting. Yeah, I can say I had a similar experience because the first thing that happened was I exited and I was in the source, if we're going to call it that. Certainly the source is best to my knowledge at this point in time, but I'm aware that there's far more out there that I don't know about yet. But I was kind of given a vision or an epiphany as I arrived about how sound can help us connect to this place. And I was also kind of had this vision of things that affect us negatively in an emotional level. So say for example, you're having a good day, you walk into the office and somebody's very upset and they come into the office. Doesn't matter, maybe they're upset with you. So they kind of unleash this anger or just general upset feeling onto you. And for a while, you can kind of stay in your centered place. But they just keep firing and firing this upset and anger at you. And eventually, they're going to pull you into this angry place. And then you get into a big argument. And so it kind of showed me how that once someone's pulled you into that place, your whole either physical body or emotional body has been affected, and that you need to find a way of releasing these emotions after the fact, because otherwise that is going to take a very long time to get rid of. And perhaps the next time somebody comes along to you and they're upset, you will enter into an argument more quickly because you're still holding on to all of this kind of emotional baggage. For want of a better term. And I think this is how certain yoga postures can help us releasing anger and tension, meditation, Tai Chi, all of these kind of practices. You could almost say a spiritual upkeep. We need to have some kind of a practice that keeps us centered and sort of close to our best and also helps us to grow and move forwards, because it's not good enough just to sort of status quo. I think most of us are interested in becoming a better person or growing in some way. I think that's probably one of the reasons we're down here. And so it kind of showed me all of these different things that affect us on a daily basis and why a kind of spiritual upkeep regime is vitally important, because otherwise we're just going to kind of fall backwards emotionally, and in terms of our awareness will become heavier, and at a certain point when consciousness becomes so heavy, all we can believe in at that point is the physical world around us, because it's just too difficult to see beyond the veil. And so when you have a spiritual practice, you're kind of lightening consciousness, let's say. And at that point, you can grasp things that are outside of yourself that others might simply just walk past. So it showed me a few of these different things that affect us. And there was almost like I could kind of see the physical body and like an energy field around the physical body. And in this sort of energy body, you could say there was pores, like in the skin. And we know how we have to clean the skin, otherwise it gets too greasy and we get spots. Well, it was showing me on this kind of energy body how emotional baggage blocks the pores up, how there's a kind of rain of energy always bombarding the planet, which keeps us rooted here, because we do need to be present.
Yeah.
To look after our body, for a start, we need to be present and interact on and drive and things like that. But this kind of rain of particles does fill in these pores in our energy body. And so if we want our consciousness to flourish, then we need to remove this energetic debris, is the term I came up with. And that's how we can connect to our intuition more easily, have these kind of mystical experiences. And sound is one way that we can dislodge this energetic debris. Sage and plants like that also can help us. That's why they're kind of used for cleansing. Mm-hmm. And so it's really, I think, anyone that's on the path needs to find the techniques that resonate with them, because there's not like one solution that fits all, but there's a lot of different techniques out there that we can use. And combined with decent nutrition and things like that, we can, I think, help move forwards.
Absolutely. And, you know, for me, when I had my experience, and I don't know if it was an out-of-body experience, I don't know if it was some sort of trans-dimensional abduction, for lack of a better term, because before I saw or felt the wholeness of Source, these beings had showed me everything that was going wrong with the planet, from pollution to murder to rape to poverty, the overall ugliness of the world.
Mm.
And then I saw the connection, and I feel that's probably why I'm so much of an activist. And for me, I feel that because because we're following a spiritual practice or consciousness path, doesn't mean that we have to ignore the external world, which is exactly what you're saying. We have to be aware of the world. On the other hand, there's the other flip side of the activist movement, which is completely working on changing the external in order to find happiness. And I feel there has to be some type of a balance there, which I'm hoping that, you know, those of us at the GIC are trying to get across and helping people to do that. But I'm wondering, I mean, with compassion, one of the things I just posted yesterday was when we're truly aligned with our spiritual nature, social responsibility becomes, it evokes a sense of responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't help but feel that the practices that you're talking about help to balance that, you know, where you're not outraged, you're more aware, and then you create a certain positive response versus reaction.
Yes. Yeah, that's certainly true. If we can, because we do react to things. Even occasionally I react in something that I'm not expecting. And now I kind of look at it, it's like, where did that come from?
Yeah.
But there are certainly a lot of people that are just very reactionary. And I'm not even sure spiritual is how a lot of people that are kind of probably listening to this show would understand it. But that also has a lot of sort of negative connotations in the general population. So, and I was actually in a meeting in California that it's getting to the point where we need to really redefine some of these terms we use, because we're kind of stuck with these outdated terms that have got negative connotations to a lot of people, and a lot of the things that we talk about perhaps wouldn't be perceived so negatively if you're talking in terms of self-development, trying to make yourself a better person, have a positive impact on others. I mean, a lot of people, I don't think, would have a problem with that.
Absolutely not, yeah.
And it's also part of a lot of the world's religions, which have very positive aspects, but also have aspects perhaps that could be improved, you could say. I think things have got clouded over the ages. So, yeah, self-responsibility, activism. I kind of look at it, the activists bring a lot of the world's problems to the general population's attention, and groups like Avas, which are really doing fantastic work, because it does allow us to come together now and say, hey, I want a rainforest for my grandchildren, and these kind of things. So it's very important that we have that, and I think the corporations are starting to get it. The short-term monetary goals can't be put in front of our long-term health and the planet's well-being, and the habits that we've adopted, rightly or wrongly, some of those need to be changed. I'm not a kind of advocate of going back to a very basic way, not too basic way of living, because there are a lot of benefits to modern life, but it's a combination of the two. And so that's the kind of activist route. I'm trying to engage in the inspiring other people to do in their heart, and more often than not, it's going to be a kind of positive contribution to society. And it doesn't matter how big or small that is, because all any of us can really do is inspire or work in harmony with our sphere of influence, whether that's just our friends, or if we're lucky to have a radio show like you, you're obviously going to reach a lot more people.
Mm-hmm.
But if all of us work towards the same aim, then a lot of the world's problems will go away, because we're going to be working in some kind of harmonious way with a greater perspective on the consequences of our actions.
Absolutely. And with that being said, I think we're both pretty much aligned in the same I don't want to say the same goal, but we're being drawn, and not only you and I, but I probably hundreds of thousands of us around the planet, in reference to that as our consciousness evolves, so shall our immediate problems, for lack of a better term, or obstacles, mm-hmm. are going to fall to the wayside, because we're going to be living and approaching life and with the idea of living in a new paradigm. And I don't want to use that as a cliche, but that's the term that comes to mind, that, you know, a new way of cooperation, a new way of self responsibility. And it's not really even new. It's just a matter of, you know, really, like you said, listening and living from the heart. And the more that we do that, we find that, oh, wow, maybe I don't want to eat that Big Mac. Or maybe I don't want to give my money to that petroleum company because what they've done to the planet. You know, things like that just seem to kind of fall into place. I don't know if that's – is that kind of what you were meaning, what you were saying earlier?
Yeah, I think that was a fair point. My diet, I definitely shifted away from junk food and things, and have gone a lot more raw. I'm not vegetarian yet, but I do like green juices and things like that. And I'm kind of interested to see the, because we've kind of got disconnected from the environment and the plants that are out there. There's still a lot of good things that we can use foraging wise. And as the world's always changing, we've definitely seen a lot of changes recently. It's hard to see exactly what's going on when you're in the middle of it, as we are now.
Mm-hmm.
But if we look back just to the last 10, 15 years, how the internet is bringing us together, how shows like yours is allowing this information to get out to like-minded people, hopefully we can spark a few thoughts in people's heads today. And you never see the ripples going out of doing something like this, but you have to hope. This is why I'm here, that something we say is of value and it goes on to take somebody forwards on their path. And so these groups that are setting up on Facebook, common interests, bringing people together, that we've got these companies that are springing up, solutions to the big problems in the world are flourishing. And so we are definitely in the time of transition from the old to a new way. And I think many of us would like that new way to be better. And the heart-based consciousness empathy, which I think is much understood, is seen generally as a weakness. But I think it's empathy as we know it is part of how we're kind of having these huge spiritual experiences by connecting to something greater than us. And that would, when we're talking about being in the sea of consciousness, that might be God. We've got to try and break it down into some kind of a language that people understand, but not a God external of ourself. We're going to go down that road, and that's kind of, I think, where these messages that have come down, it's like you are part of the creator. You can create here in a positive
ten more seconds. And so we are back after that station identification break, it seems. Let's bring Gary back. We're wrapping up here now, our last quarter of the show. We were talking a bit about the God mind and whatnot, but I feel that as we get more connected to Source, Gary, do you feel that as we get more connected, we feel more inspired to, I don't know how to say it. Let's say when I'm working, I find that when I'm in that space where I feel completely aligned with my spirit, my higher self or whatnot, I flow. My workday flows. Everything happens very easily. And for lack of a better term, I'm much more creative. I was wondering, what are your thoughts on creativity?
Yeah, definitely. I've noticed it a few times because when I would say in my 20s, I would have called myself not a very creative person. But as I developed myself, which is ongoing, and really got into yoga, a lot of the kind of creative things I did when I was at school, I used to get a lot of satisfaction from, started to flourish again. And certainly, yeah, inspiration, creating, and the workday flowing, it has touched me on a number of occasions. And I was talking to one author, and she said, well, of course your creativity is going to be growing. We're all here as creators. And it's something that we're naturally capable of doing. And so as our self-development starts to grow, I think we've got access to these kind of new tools. I would put it that way. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a lot of philosophy about ideas and the sort of great minds that have been on this planet and how they use their intuition to tap into these things. And, I think there's, a lot to be said for that kind of side of us flourishing, and it's a nice side effect of an interest in these subjects and putting some time and effort into allowing yourself to grow.
Absolutely. I forgot who used it, whether it was an artist or a writer, and they talked about the small, still voice or something to that effect, and that was their... That's when they knew they were tapped into their creativity, where they had that small, still voice or whatever that was working through them. I know many writers talk about it, where they're just like almost like in a trance. You know, we talk a lot about channeling on our show, and it's a form of it. You know, it's a form of channeling your higher self when you've put yourself into that headspace where, you know, one of the things I talk about a lot is being able to quiet your thoughts and going between the thoughts. And it seems to be such a, I don't want to say it, well, an obstacle for our society right now. People are always jumping from thought to thought because there's something else to do. What's next on the list? You know, what do I have to do next? And we never really give ourselves that opportunity to quiet our mind and allow the thought stream to slow down. And one of the greatest complaints I get from people when I'm teaching a class, let's say, on meditation, is that they can't get their mind to be quiet.
Yeah.
And I wonder, maybe you have some offerings that you could share to help us.
This is, I think, really getting to the kind of core issue that separates us. If you've managed to quieten the mind and have a realization that there is something beyond this kind of constant chattering monkey, as my yoga teacher puts it, then that's when you can really get into this kind of intuitive place and this sudden knowing of something that you would never have worked out kind of through the logical process. But using that information then propels you in sort of your life forwards in an interesting direction, because this is how I sort of changed from the Gary in the corporate world to Gary following his heart, was by following that quiet voice. So, but first of all, you have to have a confidence to follow it. And it's very helpful if you can learn to separate the mind from the intuition, and that needs practice, because it is a very quiet, subtle voice that most of us generally ignore. I think it's a kind of an instinct, like, okay, I need to get out of the house, something's about to happen, like an earthquake. Animals kind of operate on this collective unconscious level. It's all probably part of a similar thing. And in terms of techniques to try and quieten the mind, well, yoga is my main one, because the physical exercise that helps the body is one side of it, but you're really using that to fall to this place of stillness, as I would describe it. And so I'm a huge fan of an hour and 15 minutes of yoga and then a 15-minute either guided meditation or a meditation. And that's my kind of main route. My other practice is going outside in the garden, having my bare feet on the ground, which I think is very beneficial. I'm completely addicted to it. And my body kind of cries out when I'm just disconnected for too long. And that, I think, helps me to connect to the world at large. And so being in nature, away from distractions, put the cell phone either off or on silent. And then there's various techniques you can use to sort of quieten the mind. There's the, as you breathe in, I'm breathing in, I know I'm breathing in, and then you can say I'm breathing out, I know I'm breathing out, and perhaps that can help some people. I think the latest one my yoga teacher was using was I'm breathing in, I smile, I'm breathing out, I feel happy. And immediately, as soon as you start smiling, you feel better. I mean, that's quite a noticeable technique. When I kind of disengage the mind, I can almost see it either as if clouds are passing kind of in front of my eyes. That's the thought stream. I could see it that way.
Yeah.
And more recently, I've almost seen it like the kind of information flow in the Matrix film, where you have all these numbers and letters just flowing in front of your minds, and that's the kind of thought stream. And so disengaging from that and just seeing it flowing past, because it doesn't seem to stop. It's just being aware of not being involved and letting it flow for you. And, it's practice. It's definitely practice, practice, practice. I'm far from an expert. I think we all struggle. It's just the world that we live in. If we're into the computers and we're kind of rushing around, we've got responsibilities. I'm sure lots of listeners have children. So there's a constant challenge to get into this space.
Yeah.
But if we can do our best to enter it from time to time, certainly two or three times a week, I would highly recommend it.
Now, I'm wondering, Gary, if you take into consideration, because we had a gentleman on about a month ago, a good friend of ours, Jeff Harvey, and he's very adept at this type of work as well. And he was mentioning for lack of a better term, electromagnetic pollution from the electrical, the electric wires outside to our Wi-Fi in our house to to the cell phone under our pillow or anything like that. And I'm wondering if you've ever experienced anything maybe obstructing your practices. I mean, I know you said you turn off your phone and whatnot, but have you felt any, you know, we talked about subtle energies. Have you felt anything from that?
Yes, and actually I've got one client, and she's very lucky. She's got basically a 250-acre estate, no neighbours, and she turns the electricity off at night. She's got this kind of system that swaps between AC and DC.
Oh, wow.
So in that environment, we haven't got any electromagnetic pollution from any neighbour's Wi-Fi, for a start, which many of us have in the city where I live. I can turn my computer on and you're probably going to see 10 or so other Wi-Fi networks.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's without all the other things going on. But how I sleep at her house is completely different to how I sleep in the city that I live in.
Yeah.
I have, suddenly it's like going back to when I was a child, the kind of really deep, restful sleep. And it's a consistent pattern. I go there and I suddenly have these really deep sleep that I remember having when I was younger. Very rarely happens now. So I think it definitely has an impact. It's not something that we know enough about, I think. And the combination of Wi-Fi, cell phones, normal landline phones, kicking things out, and all the other modern gadgets we have definitely have some kind of either combined effect or individual effects. And that's another reason why it's good to get out, either into some place in nature or just in the garden or something, somewhere you can be away from these kind of distractions and or the sort of smog that's being caused by these appliances.
Absolutely. You know, one of the things that I notice, and it's the first thing I notice when I am, let's say I'm on a hike or something, I'm very lucky to live in the mountains, and you know, every couple of months or whatnot, we'll take a drive out or I'll do a hike somewhere. And when you're out in the middle of nowhere, it's just amazing how quickly your mind slows down and how you become connected to that very moment. And, you know, we talk about being here now. So many of us live in our minds. You know, we live in our heads. We live like we were just talking about, moving on to the next thing. You know, what do I have to do? What do I have to do? There's nothing like that when you're in nature. You know, you're completely disconnected and you're like, wow, look at that. Look at that tree. Look at that mountain. Look at the rock, you know. And I think it's because, and this is a sad symptom, that we're so disconnected from nature that when we go into something like that, we're just so in awe that it really is. It's become a tool. At least for me, it's become a tool.
Definitely. Well, the other trick the mind likes to play is it's either going to try and get you to fixate on something in the past, so you're going to have regrets about something. So a lot of people spend a lot of time regretting what they've done. And then you've got a lot of people that are constantly worrying about things in the future.
Yeah.
And I think I was listening to something recently, and it said a lot of the things that you worry about never happen, and it's the things that come out of the blue and surprise you, and normally the things you should have been worrying about. So yes, twined in a lot of these subjects that we're discussing is what I would call a kind of inner strength. Sometimes you do have to dig very deep to quieten the mind. It's not something that's particularly easy. There's a definite difference in my view of external strength in terms of somebody appearing very strong externally and an inner strength to do the right thing when you know the right thing to do and doing it, rather than kind of giving in to the emotions or perhaps something that's upset you, guiding you to try and hurt somebody in return for a perceived feeling of hurt that you've received. But you know, it's not the right thing. Hurting somebody in return for being hurt is kind of a cycle that's not good to get involved in if you can avoid it. So by developing this inner strength, we can start to quieten the mind, control some of these kind of emotional things that we've constantly struggled with. I certainly struggle with these things. And slowly, by step by step, it gets easier. Mm-hmm. So yes, we just need to follow these things and keep practicing. That's all the best advice I can give to anyone. Try and practice quieting the mind and paying attention to those, to the quiet voice that's trying to give you guidance. It's intuition or higher self, is my way of looking at it.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, one of the things I find for me when I started on this path, especially as a young man in my 20s, was, you know, I don't want to say we're programmed, but we are habitualized to always have, you know, the busy mind, but not only the busy mind, to have the external distractions of either TV on, radio on, mm-hmm. Friends coming over, telephone, being on the telephone, and I'm talking before the internet. I was in my 20s in the 90s, so we didn't have, you know, iPhones and Netflix, you know.
Yeah.
But I remember I always had to have the TV on in the background, or I had to have some music playing in the background, or I was on the telephone, or I had to have friends with me. I didn't ever want to be alone. And I remember little by little how hard it is. And I don't know how it is if I were to have started doing this now. Maybe it's easier with someone a little bit more mature. But how scary it is to be alone with your thoughts, and what courage it takes to just sit there in silence and not be comfortable with yourself. And I think that probably is probably one of the first steps to quieting the mind and going into that listening to the intuition. What do you think about that, Gary?
Yeah, I think you raised a very good point. Another aspect is being comfortable in your own company. I wasn't very good at it. Since those days, I've ended up traveling around the world and just jumping on planes and being by myself, and that's fine.
Yeah.
But it's not easy, and it is definitely part of what people struggle with. I mean, the mind plays a lot of tricks on us, and I can understand why some people are made to feel uncomfortable. And I think a way to help yourself with that is by dealing with some of the past things, quite often emotional issues. Relationships are always very difficult on a number of different levels. People that we've loved and felt let down by, it's a kind of common pattern. So part of my journey has been doing my best to confront some of these things that I've gone through, making peace with them, trying to address perhaps if I was unjust in my actions by apologizing. Sometimes an apology isn't enough if you've done something too wrong, but it is what is something we can do. Extend the olive branch and just try and work through these different things and go right back, because I would say we kind of come in clean from this source that we were talking about earlier.
Yeah.
And we take on board how people treat us. We obviously, from parents at a very young age, the people around us, and we've built up this pattern of behavior that then when you become sort of more self-conscious as you grow and learn as you get older, it's like, well, actually those patterns of behavior don't serve me any longer. But they're so ingrained a lot of the time that they're very difficult to change. So we definitely have to confront what we feel is holding us back and try and work through some of these things. I would highly recommend that, as difficult as a lot of it may be. Just use your inner guidance and what you think is right. And hopefully there'd be a few pleasant surprises as a result.
Absolutely. And, you know, I'm curious now to bring everything back full circle. When you're at some of these sacred sites, and I've heard of things like this happening, and I've seen them during certain practices that I've done, whether it be a ceremony or ritual that I've done on a public level, there is some type of spontaneous healing taking effect. And what I mean by that is what you're talking about right now, an emotional healing. I've seen situations where people are, let's say we're doing a meditation out in nature, and someone will just start bawling their eyes out. And they don't know why, but a few minutes later, they understand why, that they remember a certain, you know, a tragedy or a trauma that happened to them, and it just comes out literally out of nowhere. I can't help but wonder and ask you if something like that has happened with you, or have you heard of anything like that happening at any of these sites that you guys will be hitting?
Definitely. And I do see it as a big part of what I'm here to try and help with. And there's, I mean, there's lots of different things that have happened. I've had huge releases. I'm a big fan of crying and letting things out.
Oh, yeah.
Of the system. I'm not ashamed of admitting it. And sometimes a good cry definitely helps.
Absolutely.
And I have worked with mantras, which is something we haven't covered. I'm a big fan of mantras and chanting. And some of these places take you to just this deep sense of beauty, and sometimes reflecting on my own actions. I mean, my normal one is getting very sad about the environmental destruction and lack of respect.
Yeah.
Huge lack of respect for our for the animal kingdom, the insect kingdom, etc. Because we do live on a beautiful planet with the most amazing creatures surrounding us, and many of us probably have our own pets and animals. Yeah, just they don't need a lot, a bit of love, and their hearts are given freely like that.
Yeah.
So that quite often upsets me, but also propels me forwards on my own journey and trying to inspire people. And so it's emotional healing. We did have a few people break down in Egypt with us, because there's kind of this point, again, it ties into this sort of feeling of isolation. Perhaps you're the only one that really cares about these things, and it's not a good place to be. I was there for a long time.
Yeah.
And then suddenly you're with all these amazing people that care as much as you do, or more, or just care. I think that's the important thing. And you suddenly get it. It's like, okay, that dark world that I thought I lived in, that I was trying to struggle through all of these problems by myself, I'm with these other people that want to listen to my problems and do care about it. And they get it. There's the kind of get it. And I have those people that come to the conferences, and it's their first time in a group of like-minded company. And it's just so empowering. It really touches people. So I have quite a few people that cry, and I've always got a hug on standby at that point.
Of course.
a decent hug, not a superficial hug. I'm not
right.
Superficial hugs.
A real hug.
Yeah. And it's okay. And it's definitely part of the growing process. So yeah, don't be afraid of crying and letting things out. I think it's very much needed.
Absolutely. Okay, so as we're getting ready to wrap up here, we have about about 2 minutes left, Gary. Tell us and remind us a little bit more of the name of the tour, and where can we find information for it?
Well, the next one, just to mention quickly, I'm off to Egypt next month, flying out on April the 13th. And that all of the tours that I'm working on are on my infinite-connections.co.uk website. You can easily find me under Egypt and Gary Evans on Google. And so I'm really looking forward to that. That's going to be with Brian Falster and Chris Dunn, Patricia and Yusuf. My July tour, the megalithic temples of ancient Britain and Ireland. That's going to combine the kind of spiritual self-development side with the ancient sites and the mysteries. We discuss a lot of the anomalies and things, and teach people dowsing. And then Brian's working on a tour to Peru in August. I'm collaborating on that with him and Lloyd Pye. And I've kind of got a very special spiritual journey to Egypt, hopefully in December with Patricia and Yusuf, sort of taking it on to the experiential level, which is what I really love sharing with people, seeing how these places can still touch people today and how much they mean to us. So that's kind of my main upcoming tours. And wonderful. Yeah, just reach out on Facebook, Infinite Connections, Gary Evans. I'm always around.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for filling in for Maria. Maria will be rescheduling with us, everyone. And we will have her on the show. I hope she feels better very soon. We thank you so much for joining us today, Gary.
There is no denying the world is awakening. We see it in the global uprisings and demonstrations of the people around the planet and the new way of thinking and living that is arising naturally within each one of us and our communities. I have been a major player in this global shift and movement for over 20 years and have helped tens of thousands of people around the world change their lives and find their voice in order to help create the paradigm change we so desperately need. Join me here at Revolution Radio on the Just Bernard Show every Tuesday at noon Eastern Time for 2 hours of powerful interviews and discussion with some of the most influential visionaries of consciousness, alternative media, and suppressed knowledge. We promise to reveal the real matrix and empower your human experience.